sound.
Yeah. Well, you know, so come on in, son.
Oh, right.
Okay. Come on in, son. Let's
scared of getting my coffee near you.
No, that's all right. Don't be.
Jeez. Have you seen that? This is.
Can
great.
You just keep. By the way. No, it's okay. By the way.
Recording already.
Alex, keep this in. Just keep it in. Just keep all this shit in. It's all good.
Okay.
So nothing like a little bit of pre-podcast banter.
Banter.
You know, to sort of, to lube things up.
I'll be distracted by all this. You realise that, don't you?
Yeah, that's okay. That's
I'm just be going, God, things I need to
it's
play
It's all
with.
Smoke and mirrors, mate. All smoke things and mirrors. I need to play it's all about appearance. It's all about... Anyway, g'day there. Welcome to Melbourne Unreal, where we are mastering music and mastering life. I'm Tony Jack the Bear Mance, and we're coming to you from Deluxe Mastering in Melbourne, Australia, the world's most livable city, and I'm absolutely delighted to have as my guest today, Mr. Bob Spencer. G'day, mate.
Pleasure to be here.
Good to see you too, but it's we had a one false start, but anyhow, we finally got there.
But we did have cake.
We did have cake and cookies and cookies. Regular cookies.
Regular cookies. Regular very cookies, chocolatey.
But they were just
very chocolatey. Where's the camera in that, by the way?
No, it's right in front of us, mate.
Is it on the left or the right?
Well, it's kind of somewhere.
I don't know.
I got no fucking idea, mate. Ultimately, we're just fucking winging it, mate.
We are.
We go through life just winging it.
Script's gone. No script.
No one. Everyone's walking around thinking they got a fucking clue, and no one has a fucking clue.
I agree with that.
With life, we're just.
I completely agree.
It's just this. We're all improvisers.
We're all just going. I think I'll go over here. Yeah, that feels all right.
Oh, what does that button do?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
the red
life,
one.
Life.
It's absolutely.
Yeah.
Oh, it's good to have you here, mate.
You too. It's good. Good to be here. I won't rest it. There you go.
No, that's all right. It's okay. That's all right.
No, I'm old school, man. Things don't go near the desk.
Yeah, I know. You've had some. I was up at the Grove Studios with Scott Horscroft from EMI. He used to be Gary Beer Studio from InXS.
Yeah, yeah.
Scott Horscroft.
Mangrove.
Yeah, the old Mangrove, exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
So Scott Horscroft now has taken it over and he's operating it as a studio, but he also has these courses that he teaches, Cert 3 and 4 audio production for kids up there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And so one of the engineers there, Jack Negro, one of his young assistants, was telling me the story about one guy that actually managed to inadvertently tip some red wine into the SSL, which didn't go down very well with Scott.
No.
But you hear some horror stories sometimes about that kind of shit. But man. Yeah. So anyway, Bob, what have you been up to, man? Where you been? What's been happening in your world?
I've started recording this damn album.
Yeah, you've been crowdfunding
thing, which went well. It's really. It's very confronting doing something like that. It's pretty much, here's my bum, showing it to the world. It was kind of scary, but it turned out pretty well. There's a lot more involved than I thought would be involved.
Yeah.
It's not simply a matter of going, send, and watching your bank account. There's a lot of work to be done every day, mostly through social media, getting on top of it every day, responding to a lot of emails, all that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
But it was a worthwhile endeavour.
Where are you at with it right now?
So the crowdfunding finished a couple of weeks ago, waiting for some stragglers to...
chip in and their pledges to...
Yeah, to fix... Sometimes people put in incorrect bank account details and stuff like that. So that'll probably get sorted out next week.
Mm-hmm.
And what that will allow me to do is put funds towards the things that I can't do at home.
Mm-hmm.
And we're off and running. So I've given myself a few months to finish the album.
Mm-hmm.
Doing things by yourself is kind of cool. However, I miss the quality friction of being in a band.
Yep.
There are times when you're in a band where you're an idiot, that sucks, where that stuff is actually really beneficial.
Mm-hmm.
And overseeing everything myself can get a little bit, I can get a bit introspective. So get out of the house, go for a walk, mm-hmm. go to the shops, mm-hmm. have a cup of coffee.
But I think it's pretty interesting. Yeah, I think artists in general, though, tend to be very self-critical and... very hard taskmasters unto ourselves. And quite often we want the validation of our particularly our peers or people who we respect to validate it. But I think it's also important that you're open to constructive criticism from others, and that's where you need the outside influence coming into the picture. So I completely understand where you're coming from in that respect. But again, you know, criticism is one of those funny things because, you know, sometimes, but even sometimes when it comes from that place of piss and vinegar, there can be, if you can detach emotionally from it, there usually are kernels of truth in there somewhere.
Oh, yeah, and that's a good thing about being in a band with players that you respect, that you don't necessarily agree with all the time, but you respect. So I'm kind of missing that, which means that occasionally I chuff off something to one of my mates, and you know, does this sort of sound like it's in the ballpark to you? But it's a really interesting thing to have written so much material for the bands that I was in, and now I'm writing everything, and I'm thinking, is that chorus any good? Is that the best thing I've ever heard, or is it just tragically bad?
Yeah.
You know, some of the things that, you know, you hear things in your head, and I'm sure that every other artist goes through similar things. You hear something, and one of the responses is, this is great! And then after a little while, you think, but hang on, if I think it's good, probably everybody else is going to think it's shit. So this constant...
Dichotomy
battle. You're ambivalent. You know, all those sort of two-sided things are going on. Is this great? Is it really horrible? I'm not sure. Yeah. You know how you hear something sometimes when a third party does it, and you just go, "Oh, that sucks. That's just terrible."
Mm.
But when it's me, it's like, "That sucks." No, it's great. No, it sucks.
Jimmy Page mentioned something about he related to farting. He said, When you fart, it's okay. When someone else does it, it stings.
Yeah. It's funny, isn't it?
Oh, kind of lines.
And music is, I find, very much like that.
Absolutely. I reckon songwriting is probably the hardest skill of them all in this art form, mate.
Yes. Songwriting for me is... It might start with a riff, but a riff is not a song.
Correct.
So the challenge for me is I write a lot of riffs. In fact, my problem is that I can't stop. I mean that quite seriously.
I believe you.
It sort of fills my head. But
yeah.
So that was an interesting sound. So I have this multitude of riffs, and I think some of them are pretty good. Turning them into a song or them into songs, that's difficult. So when it comes time for me to do that, I do a few things. I see the structure of the song in terms of shapes, not quite colors, but I see shapes.
Yeah.
So I ask myself if the, and I'm doing this because that's what I see.
Yeah, yeah.
I ask myself if the shape is right for those parts.
Mm-hmm.
And then another thing I do is I try to remember things that I learned from, for example, Greg McCaich.
Yeah.
He's
arguably one of the greatest. I put him and Don Walker up here in that real upper echelon of Australian songwriters.
I actually put him at the top, with no disrespect.
No, absolutely. No, for sure.
Fantastic. So occasionally I do that conscious thing of, all right, now what sort of things did Greg do? Greg was magnificent at a lot of things, arrangements, parts. A thing that he was really good at was always delivering a lyric that was relevant to the song, which I have difficulty with. I get all these images and I think, oh, that's a cool image. It's not really relevant, but I like it, so I'll shove it in.
Yeah.
Whereas Greg's lyrics. And other songwriters that I like, Woody Guthrie, I, I adore Woody Guthrie, Warren Zevon, Randy Newman.
How good's Warren Zevon?
It's fantastic. Apparently a total nut of it.
Who else, you know, who else would write a song called Roland the Headless Thompson Gunner? You know? Great fucking titles.
That's a great album.
It is. Insolvable Boys are there. Yeah, yeah.
I still listen to that album. It's, yeah. It's magnificent.
And rest in peace, poor fellow. I mean, that was he was a sad loss.
He was, but till the very end, he was fighting.
Yeah. And Zappa, too.
Yep.
Love Frank Zappa. I mean, have you seen some of Zappa's interviews, particularly when he's debating politicians? Oh, I mean,
he's too smart.
He was just that guy was so far ahead of the curve that he sort of did a round trip back and looped everyone. Do you know what I mean? He was just awesome. I mean, I'll never forget that. I got into Zappa when I was in high school. When I was a kid, all the kids were into pop music, which was fine, but I got into progressive jazz.
Yeah.
So, you know, Weather Report, Stanley Clarke.
Right.
Yeah, the usual fucking suspects. And then one of my friends put me on the Zappa, and Joe's Garage was the first thing I heard of Frank Zappa's, and I was just completely fucking blown away.
The first one I heard was Hot Rats.
Oh, okay, yeah. With Stefano Grappelli playing another one of my...
And, you know, I was listening to, things that were far simpler by comparison. But later on, after Hot Rats, I then got into King Crimson.
Yep.
Yes. Focus. Mm. Those three bands in particular.
I'll tell you something about Focus. The first guitar riff that blew my fucking mind.
Hocus Pocus.
I was a little kid watching. You would remember there was Happening Star. 68, Uptight 7. There was Rusty Wiley.
Rusty Wiley,
Channel O, as it was back then. And I remember I was this young kid listening to this riff. This Hocus Pocus riff.
It's magnificent. To this day, it's magnificent.
Blew my fucking mind, Bob Spencer.
Ackerman is just... Oh! The guy's a god, and I'm... On guitar forums, I often mention him, and I'm sort of dismayed as to how underrated the guy is. I think the guy's a god. I mean, I put him up on a pedestal.
Yeah.
Magnificent.
And another one of those guys, Alan Holdsworth.
Holdsworth is...
Have you seen some of the chords that... Like, how the fuck do you stretch your hands that far over that many frets?
I've read... I don't know whether it's true, but I've read that he can put his first finger in the 12th fret and hit any note in the remaining 12 frets.
Jesus.
So that's a span like... That's what I've read. I don't know whether that's true. The guy's great, but he's such a dreadful interviewee.
Oh, really?
Oh, God, he's just... It's
just droll? Is he just supposed to droll?
Oh, it's terrible. It's kind of that, I've influenced everybody, but I can't pay the rent. It's, okay, whatever. I mean, I feel sorry for the guy in a sense, but he certainly doesn't understand the showbiz aspect of showbiz.
Yeah, yeah. But that's something... I think some people have a natural charisma for it, and some people can learn it, but I think it's got to be in you somehow, man, you know?
Maybe. I don't know. Maybe.
You're a good performer. You rock out all right.
I came up through an era where, quite seriously, if people didn't like your show and the way you played, they threw things at you. So, and what we did... very much informed what was going to happen for us in the next month. So if we just didn't perform well for a few weeks, then the gigs would just dry up.
Yeah.
In the era that I came through. So a lot of us got onto that show biz very early. When you look at the 70s bands, the bands I was in,
Angels,
Angels and
Skyhooks,
AC/DC, Skyhooks. Most of those bands understood the value of show, and to this day I still appreciate show. And when people have the opportunity to go to a gig and they later talk about the gig, they 99% of the time people say, I saw a band on Saturday. I've not yet come across anybody who said, I'm sure there's somebody, but I haven't yet come across somebody who said, I heard a band on the weekend. Everybody says, I saw a band. So there's that visual thing. And if you don't engage people in some visual form. And for a band like Pink Floyd, it might be lights.
Yeah.
For early Skyhooks, it was costumes or whatever. But if you don't engage people on a visual level, then they're less inclined to tell their friends about it.
About, and,
you know, they don't have as clear a memory of it.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I was lucky that I came, or fortunate that I came up through that era where we concentrated on our playing, but we were also conscious of providing a show. Otherwise, the gigs dried up.
Yeah, yeah,
it was, it's as simple as that. The gigs dried up. These days, it's kind of different because of social media, where people see a video and they might end up with 24.5 million hits on that. And in fact, the show for that band might be as boring as
Batshit,
you know, but you know, a few million hits later. So it's kind of different. I'm not saying that's better or worse. It's just different. And it's very interesting that it's different.
Yeah, I think so. It's always evolving. I think the model of the music industry is just, I think it's been in a state of flux for some time.
Yeah.
I think now with streaming, it's kind of finding some new model. But what I find interesting when I have discussions with people about music and the money that's made, I think it's a misnomer that people believe that back in the so-called halcyon days of record sales and when people were actually buying physical product pre-internet, pre-file sharing, pirating, etc., that artists made a lot of money. And you tell people, you know, that wasn't the case at all. The people that made the money were the labels.
Yeah, we didn't. I don't mean to be crying poor. I don't like that. But when you look at the dollars, a great example is an Angels album that went number one here, cost us $500,000 to make.
Which one was that?
Beyond Salvation.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I can't remember how many years it took to recoup. So in other words, recoup is where you've paid off the loan from the record company and then you finally make a cent from it.
Mm.
So number one, double platinum, all that stuff. Mm. But I think our recoupment was a few years before we made a cent out of that album. And again, that's not to bitch, but that was the state of the industry back then.
Yeah.
And, you know, had we been wiser, had we had business mentors, which none of us had, maybe we wouldn't have made those choices. We would have been more careful about what we'd done and where we spent our money. And particularly, well, you're aware of this, we used to hire recording studios for months and months at a time, and some days we'd do nothing except get Japanese takeaway.
Yeah.
And some days we'd record a vocal through one microphone, one mic pre on one channel of a 24
tape machine. Yeah,
that's a lot of money to be spending for a vocal.
It was very indulgent. I guess you had the experience though of travel to working with engineers and producers that you always admired and respected, experience.
That was fantastic. I learned a lot I learned a lot about engineering. That's by incessantly asking questions. Why does that do that? Why are you doing that? Why does that go there? What does that do?
Yeah.
Asking a lot of questions, working with good engineers, and also building up, even though I didn't know it at the time, building up skills to work with people.
Yeah.
At the time, I didn't know I was accruing skills, but I was. How I deal with somebody, what happens when there's friction, how do you navigate your way through some sort of problem? Yeah. But I didn't know that I was learning those things back then, but I was.
But it's true. I think that one of the things kids have come through here for work experience and one of the early things I learned from my first mentor, Rick Essig, who said to me that 80% of this business is bullshit.
Mm.
To which I responded, well, what do you mean? And he's saying, well, it's all about relationships. Mm. It's all about how you engage with people. You need good ears, you need all those things are obviously part of the equation, but it's always going to be the guy that is more engaged with the project, that is more invested emotionally to the record, who is really into the care factor.
Yeah.
Of, you know, and like I said, it's dealing with people. It's just that understanding of what's going on, and like you said, to be able to navigate any friction or any kind of disputes or that kind of thing. And ultimately, we want to work with people that we like. If we don't like people and trust them, it doesn't matter if they got, you know, 20 million fucking platinum albums on the wall. I mean, that's all very nice and great, but, you know, they're, I mean, I think from memory, Bob Ezrin, who I have enormous respect for, for his body of work, but he was a challenging guy to work with.
Have you worked with him?
No, I haven't, but when I was over in Canada, he was working out of phase one, and there were people there that knew him well. He's a Torontonian. And was saying, you know, well, the guy's a fucking genius, but he was just a difficult guy to work with. And no doubt he got the best out of his artists, and he created seminal fucking pieces of work that are timeless, you know. But again, it's like how much are you prepared to endure with a personality that is difficult, you know, shall we say, to be, you know, trying to be diplomatic here. But anyway, look, the work speaks for itself, so... You know, you can't say anything against him about that. But I know I would rather deal with someone who is a little bit easier to work with and a little bit more chilled, you know.
And they like you, you like them, they come back, and that's good for your business, and you keep getting to do what you enjoy.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, there aren't a lot of reasons to do, for example, if you did a great, in your case, mastering job and you and the client just didn't get along and that person never came back.
It's funny. I often get asked, I say, oh, surely you must get people that are... There's some misconception from the general public that musicians or rock stars are arrogant. And it's like, they're just fucking people, dude. They're just people.
I find that my experience is that most creative people in the business are pretty easy to get along with. And I've found the most difficult people... actually the ones who are the least creative and who kind of ride on the coattails of, this is my experience. I'm not suggesting everybody else's.
That's all you can project here, mate. Your reality. That's all you can do.
The people that I've worked with who are very creative are generally pretty easy to get along with. And they might be emotional, sure, but pretty easy to get along with. But my worst experiences have been with people who... what I call hang on the coattails of those who are creative, not actually bringing anything to the party and letting their egos get attached to that. So they've been my worst experiences. The best experiences have been with creative people. As we said earlier, having those delicious cakes, I have the utmost respect for Greg McCage, and I get along with Greg to this day. We're still friends. We're good friends. He's a very, as everybody I'm sure is aware, he's a very creative and insightful guy. Not difficult, certainly not more difficult than, you know, other people. Might have the occasional, well, I think it should go this way, and I really would like it to go this way. But every songwriter does. I'm sure Warren Zevon did that.
Zappa too.
Yeah.
I'm sure. Absolutely. Definitely Zappa.
Definitely Zappa. I can't imagine Frank saying, oh, just do whatever.
Whatever. Just good enough.
Yeah, throw the sheet music away. That wasn't going to happen.
No way. So listen, tell me about Raw Brit. Because Raw Brit's been an interesting thing.
It's been a lot of fun. So the band is a good band. John Favaro on bass from the Bad Loves, and also plays with Mark Seymour in the Undertow. Peter Maslin, Maz from Boom Crash Opera. Sensational drummer. Nick Peeling.
Yeah, say no more.
What can you say?
Yeah.
And I get to hang out with them. So it's a damn good band. It's only British music that's rock from, say, 67, 68 to 74.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. In other words, it's the British music that informed particularly Mick and I.
Mm-hmm.
So it's Free, Led Zeppelin, The Who... that sort of
thing.
Deep Purple. It's a lot of fun. It's just a gas being able to play those songs with this quality band. The players are just fantastic. Everybody's really easy to get along with.
Yeah.
So it's a lot of fun. We don't play that often. Maybe once every 5 or 6 weeks. Everybody's busy we're all grown-ups, we have families and that sort of stuff.
Don't grow up, Bob Spencer. It's overrated. I don't endorse it.
We have.
I really don't. I tried it and it just does not work.
My point is that we have things to do. We all have, as everybody does these
absolutely,
days.
For sure.
So we don't get to play that often, but when we do, it's really good fun.
And it becomes more of an occasion too. I think there's something about...
We hang, we have dinner, you know, we do all that stuff.
That's great. Camaraderie, all that kind of stuff.
It's no post-mortems.
Yeah.
You know, we might appraise a gig later, but it's not like the old days where there's screaming and chairs being thrown in the dressing room. It's not, you know, it's nothing like that. It's we might call each other a couple of days later, you know, not quite sure about that thing that we did, blah, 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 blah. And we have business meetings, which I advise every band to do.
Yeah.
Have business meetings, make them regular. No matter where your band is at, even though Raw Bread are right in terms of turnover and whatever, we're right down there somewhere, but we take it seriously. We have business meetings, we discuss our short-term and long-term goals.
Mm-hmm.
Goals for us. We're not expecting them to be great for anybody else, but they're goals that we would like to achieve. And I'd suggest that any band watching, or you know, player in a band watching this, one bit of advice, have business meetings.
Yeah. And what about getting stuff in writing?
Yes. Now, we all like to get everything in writing, even though I trust the blokes in the band with my life. We still cover everything in emails, so that there's none of that. I don't remember.
He said, she said.
Yeah, it's none of that. So that no, and we take notes at our business meetings.
Minutes.
So we have minutes.
Mm-hmm.
That in no way suggests that we don't get along. We do. We get along famously. But it's just that having everything in writing makes everything really clear, transparent, as they say these days.
Yeah.
And all our dealings with venues are in writing. They may start with a phone call, but the phone call is followed up with an email.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, so-and-so, let's just go over what we chatted about 5 minutes ago. So another bit of advice there, if I may.
Go for it, mate.
Get everything in writing. Everything in writing, because it will pay off. I know people, in fact, I was having a conversation with somebody on Facebook this morning who's being burned by the second time by somebody. And conveniently, the person who is burning him likes to make decisions on the phone and refuses to follow anything up in writing.
Right.
So
that leaves it very open-ended and very murky.
Well, either party can then burn the other party.
Yeah. You know,
someone can say, well, I'm not turning up. Oh, you have to turn up. Well, show me the email where I says, oh,
yeah, yes. Exactly. You know,
where I said I was going to turn up.
And the other thing that I think is unfortunate that certainly I've, you know, seen, heard about, and Tom Larkham is doing this really great course for artist development, which is fantastic,
right,
that he's putting together right now. But we were having a chat on the phone the other day where he was talking about how maybe not endemic, but quite often the people that you are burnt by, sadly, seem to be the people that are in your inner circle or your mates.
That I'm seeing currently, this is very fresh in my mind because I've seen a little bit of that in the last few months, and it's very, very disappointing.
Isn't it?
Yeah, it's very disappointing. It should be no more or less disappointing than any other.
No doubt. But when it comes from your mates, the people in your inner circle, you know, it's unfortunate.
Yeah,
you know,
that's,
and I guess that's another reason why it's good to get shit down in fucking writing.
Absolutely. Get everything down in writing, because you protect yourself, you protect the other person. So if you actually care about somebody else, having that agreement in writing is good for them.
Mm. I think it also shows good faith. I think if you're coming into a deal with good intent and good faith, then you're going to have no issue doing that anyway, because your intention is pure, so to speak. You're coming to do the right thing.
Yep. Yeah, I agree.
So now, one thing that people may or may not know about you, which I was not surprised to find out, and really, really sort of pricked my ears up, is that, like me, you have a real interest in youth, mentoring youth, being involved with kids, and, you know, just basically passing knowledge. And I think the guys of our generation, with the experience that we've had in the industry and in life, I think, I certainly feel that we are duty bound to...
I feel it's part of my job.
Yeah, to share knowledge, because we, no doubt you and I have been products of having good mentors ourselves.
Yep. Yep.
We can never pay these people back. They don't expect anything back, so we pay this shit forward. And I love the fact that, you know, you invest your time and your energy and your effort. So so just for people that don't know about what you do, programs you're involved with, I'd like you to tell us a bit more about that.
Now, I haven't been doing this for the last few years since I had cancer. And
how's that going, by the way?
I'm okay. I had a checkup a few weeks ago, and I saw my doctor 2 days ago.
Beautiful.
And I need the regular checkups, but yeah, I'm okay at the moment.
That's so awesome, mate. Yeah.
Unfortunately, there's the issue of cancer, and then there's all this sort of domino effect of other things that happen afterwards. So I haven't been doing this for a few years, but I want to get back into it. So what I was doing was running band programs for kids aged between 8 and 18.
Yeah.
So I'd coach them for the school term, and at the end of the school term, we'd do a gig.
Yeah.
And it was incredibly fulfilling, incredibly hard work.
Yeah, no doubt.
But it was great. The actual coaching, dealing with the kids for an hour and a half each week, the bands, I find easy, because I love working with the kids and I love watching them interact and grow, and I get feedback from the parents, and I loved all that. The difficult part was the administration, which I'm not good at.
Forget that. Paperwork,
all that stuff. I ended up having a mini stroke, which preceded my cancer. And it was due to the stress of not the coaching. The coaching for me is like, it's an absolute pleasure. It's a pleasure to be working with these kids, and I love it.
Yeah.
But the administration I found very, very difficult. So for many years, from 2001, which is the year that I started the Weekend Warrior program for adults in Victoria, up until a few years ago, I coached not only the Weekend Warriors, so adults, baby boomers in particular.
Who typically do you get at the Weekend Warriors type of situation?
It's generally male, although a lot of female singers come through. And they were people who had played an instrument while they were young. Mm-hmm. And, you know, then they went to uni, had a family, and
life
the guitar
got in the way.
Mm-hmm. You know, life got in the way. The guitar ended up being under the bed, and they hadn't touched their guitar or drumsticks or whatever for many, many years. So we'd kind of search them out.
Mm.
And encourage them to play, letting them know that they didn't have to be good. This is the first hurdle. A lot of them would say to me, or say to somebody else who was involved in the program, "Oh, I don't think I'm good enough." And I would say, "That's absolutely perfect. If you think you're not good enough, that's exactly the person that I want. What I don't want is someone coming into the program saying, "Oh, I'm fantastic," you know.
Yeah.
That's totally missing the point. And the people who came, a few people came through the program thinking that they were great, and interestingly, they're the people who didn't really make any progress.
Yeah.
It's the people who were really down on themselves and thinking that they couldn't do it who made incredible progress.
Yeah.
And lots of those people are still playing. So there are bands that I put together. When I say I put together, you know, these people.
Yeah, yeah.
In 2001, that are still playing.
That's great.
That's 15 years.
I think that does wonderful things for people, man, because you reconnect to something that you love.
Yeah.
I mean, you go, you know, particularly for those who did it, as we said, life got in the way. They're working, they're maybe doing a job they don't like doing, but to actually have a release, the creative outlet, to be able to enjoy doing something that they connect with, and it's an escape, and it's just fun.
And they also meet people who are outside their work areas. So what tends to happen for some people is that the further they go along in their career, the narrower the band, the narrower the of the band, I'm talking about EQ,
yeah.
the narrower sort of circle of friends that they have. So being in something like the Weekend Warriors meant that you would have these people from vastly different
backgrounds
who would form friendships.
Yeah, they find the common bond through music.
Yeah, through music.
Yeah. Peer group's really important, man.
Mm. Oh, yeah, it's, you know? Really, we know that through mental health. So it was a wonderful experience to be involved in all that. I do want to get back to it. I would like to find someone who would like to do administration, someone who's crazy enough to want to do that, so that I can get back into particularly helping kids. I was approached by a music shop last week to help them run an adults program, which I don't know whether I'll do yet. I'm still to have the nuts and bolts meeting on that one.
Mm-hmm.
But I do want to get back to it. I find it very rewarding, and I see the benefit it brings to people. And you see people grow over only 4 or 5 or 6 weeks. You watch their confidence and improve, and then they all freak out at the gig. It's fantastic.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, like there's all the excitement of the gig, and
that's got to be wonderful. That's got to be. I've only had one experience singing in front of a band. It was the Triple M Christmas band we just bought, that good old Cheryl was involved in. Yeah. Just singing covers, and it was such a buzz, man. I can imagine the, like, especially, you know, you play big stadiums in front of big crowds. Couldn't imagine what it feels like, man. It's got to be.
Well, for me, it's comfortable though, Tony. So it's not only a great experience, it's actually my safety zone. I now know, after years of therapy, that playing a gig is where I feel safe.
Yeah.
So that's my
sanctuary.
That's my sanctuary. Everybody has a different thing.
Yeah.
It might be, you know, playing golf or I don't know what, but for me, it's actually being on stage. So the reason I look comfortable on stage, or I'm told that I look comfortable on stage, is because I actually am comfortable on stage.
Yeah. Yeah.
I feel more at ease on stage than I feel anywhere else.
Yeah. Tommy, do you still enjoy music?
Yeah.
For the sake of music?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. And it's funny. When I was in my early 20s, I started to develop fears around music, like, oh my God, maybe I'll never be able to write anything again. And I wonder if I'll still enjoy this when I'm 60. And all that stuff falls away. I am nearly 60 and I love it as much as I ever did.
Bullshit, you're not only 60.
59
in a couple. Are you fucking serious?
Yeah, I'll be 59 in a
couple. You look fucking awesome, dude.
Oh.
Yeah, you do. You look great. You're in good shape.
I'm getting there. I want to get in better shape this year.
Are you working out or doing anything?
I haven't been because I've had all these shoulder and back issues, but I will be again, yeah.
No, seriously, dude. Yeah. You're looking fucking awesome.
Thank you. But I am nearly that age, but
don't you love aging?
I love it.
I
love it. I find it fascinating. I find it fascinating people say, oh, wouldn't you like to be young again? Absolutely
no, no,
not.
No, 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 no. Fucking have it.
I'm, you know, the body falls apart, but I'm okay with that. You know, things don't work quite the way they did, but that's okay. That's just, you accept that.
I think there's something, in my experience anyway, getting older, and as you become more comfortable within your own skin and more at peace with who you are and just accepting you for who you are, there's something very... a certain tranquility that I get
over
it. It's
liberating.
And it allows you, you know, we talked a bit before about, you know, how you become more authentic, you know, and through just letting go of your masks, more of your masks and more of your bullshit and stuff like that, and just to be able to be, you know. And there's something really nice in that, and I've certainly been enjoying that process, because for many people, they never really get to that stage, usually until they're facing mortality, you know, people in hospices and, and this is where, and sadly for many, you know, they only get there at the end, but you don't need to wait that far, you know?
Yeah. It is confronting though to go to the process that you need to go through to be reasonably comfortable with yourself is a confronting process, because you need to face whatever fears, and as we spoke earlier, you're going to do something on fear later. That's a really important thing. Can I face my fears? Do I accept that I have any fears? That might be one of the early questions.
Yeah.
Because there are people that deny that they have any problems at all. I mean, so you've got to accept, okay, I have these fears, I have these concerns, I have these things going on that I need to address. Am I willing to confront them? Because it's really hard, and as you know, it's very hard, and it's very upsetting to go through these sorts of things, and then you can try your best, and then out the other side, you know what? I'm okay.
Yeah. Oh, I think ultimately that's the bottom line. I think knowing that you're okay, you know, because we were born okay. Mm. We didn't, all this fear and insecurity are not things that you're born with. These are things that are programmed into you, you know, and always inadvertently through well-meaning parents and, Bob, you're being naughty, as opposed to you're not naughty, it's just your behaviour that's naughty. So we link, you know, so when people say, you know, I am angry. No, you're not angry. You're just a person experiencing the emotion of anger at this moment.
My parents came through the age group that was, well, you know, authoritarian. My way or the highway. And as billions of other people have gone through. That's one of the things that drove me to music. I was talking about safety earlier, and one of the things I've since realized is that I've spent my life in music because I feel safe in music, because I didn't feel safe in my family environment.
Were they supportive of your musical pursuits when
oddly
you were younger?
They kind of were. My parents are weird.
You're weird. I'm weird too, buddy. We're weird too.
I did have support from them. My parents did this weird thing where sometimes they'd be over here and sometimes they'd be over there, and okay, I don't quite get this, but maybe they didn't get it either.
Mm.
You know, so they were supportive of music. They wanted me to be happy, and my father, of course, continued to tell me how I should run my music career.
Mm.
You should do this, you should do that, you should do this, you should do that. Mm-hmm. It's very funny.
Yeah.
But they were supportive, particularly in the early days where my father drove me to and from guitar lessons from the time I was 9 till 16.
So
years of guitar lessons. Mm-hmm. And before I had my license, my parents drove me to and from gigs.
Mm-hmm.
So they did all that stuff, and that was great.
I think you're very fortunate. I think for quite a few of our generation, it was mine was interesting because my dad was very much against it. He was all about academia, coming from an academic, you know, family and whatever. Mm. But my mum, though, she was great. My mum never understood what I wanted to do. She just knew it was music related.
Yeah.
And all she ever said to me was, look, I don't know what it is that you're wanting to do. All I know is that it makes you happy.
Yeah.
And
as
a parent, that's all you can really ask of your kid. You just want to see your kids happy.
Yeah. That's what I want. Yeah.
Did a video the other day about kids doing these courses. You know, so many kids are doing these courses, Bob, that they feel like they're pressured into it, or they don't have other options. So fuck it, I'll just go to uni because I have to do something. And it's a fallback thing.
Well, hopefully that leads to something else.
Yeah, you know, but I remember I told my kid, you know, I suggested to her, take a year off after high school. You spent 13 fucking years in school, 14, whatever, if you want to count kindergarten.
Yeah.
And so this is all you've known, this structured life of being at school and homework and books and study and shit. It's like, go out in the world, experience a bit of life, make a little bit of money, see what else is out there.
Mm.
You know, you get into your course and then You can come back to it fresher. You may discover something else along the way. You know, those kind of weird things that send you on a different trajectory in life.
Yeah, I'm all for that. I don't personally believe that kids should go directly from high school to university. I definitely think that kids should be taking a year or two off.
And they get to grow a little bit and mature a little bit and go out and meet new people, different circles of people, experience.
Maybe travel.
Travel.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I think, you know, I think any kid that has the opportunity to leave, especially Australia, because I think travel, first of all, it's wonderful to open up your mind and experience different countries and cultures and food and music and art and all that kind of stuff. But I think also you really get an appreciation of where you're from. You know, I think we're the best country in the world, Bob Spencer.
Yeah, I think we're...
Maybe I'm a little bit biased.
No, I think we're very fortunate.
But I think, you know, we can sit and we can complain about, you know, we could have this and this, but, you know, we've got healthcare, we've got reasonable public transport, we have roads you can drive on. We don't, you know, we can... You and I are going to be able to walk out of this building today and we're not going to be concerned about some fucking drone that's going to be firing down on us or, you know, or some fucking landmine that's been left from 20, 30 odd fucking years ago. You know? We've got a reasonably clean food supply. We can we got hot and cold. You know, these are little things we take for granted. You know what I mean? We got we got a septic system that's not overflowing in the fucking streets. And do you know what I mean?
We have a lot to be grateful for. I agree.
But I think until you until you step out of here, see what else is going on.
You have no frame of reference, unless you go out and see other countries and see how other places work. I agree. I feel very fortunate to be living in Australia. I would like my stepdaughter to see other cultures, other countries. We have a bit of a fuzzy goal of going to Mongolia to build community housing.
Cool.
So it may not happen this year, but maybe it'll happen next year.
Yeah.
That's something we really would like to do, and we'd like my stepdaughter to see that and what goes on in it. I've always wanted to go to Mongolia.
Yeah, what's your fascination? Are you one of Genghis Khan's?
Who knows? I need to get my DNA done.
I mean, that guy, he just rampaged, didn't he?
I can't remember what the figure is, how many people are related to him.
Over a thousand, oh, maybe more, but geez, he was a busy bloke.
He was a very busy bloke. So that's something that we'd like to do. And you know, I've seen a little bit of the rest of the world, not a lot. And I really do appreciate living in Australia. And it's, you know, it's a good place.
Yeah, it is a good place. Well, Bob Spencer, we're going to wind it up here. And so I appreciate you, man.
Man,
it's been a pleasure. Fucking hug, man. You're fucking awesome. Thank you so much for coming in today. We'll get you back because it's... One thing I love about this podcast is just it's really nice to sit down with people of our industry where we can talk about music and we can talk about life stuff and shit that matters, man. Shit that's fucking real, you know? And that, you know, that other people think about as well because, you know, we get so tied up in superficiality and bullshit, and it's just nice to have an honest conversation and just put out different ideas and thoughts about things and share this kind of stuff.
It's been my pleasure. I'd love to come back.
Yeah, mate. It'd be fucking awesome. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Absolute pleasure, mate. So we'll get you back. So that's it from us. We are out of here. So thank you very much for being with us. It's been great chatting with you. And I'll leave you as I always say, please be nice to each other. But more importantly, be nice to yourselves. Okay, I love you fuckers. See you later, guys. Bye. And that, Mr. Bob Spencer, is the podcast.
Thank you, Tony. That was a pleasure.
Isn't that great?